Young people are much more likely to change things than older people. Because the older we get, the easier we settle for the status quo, the easier we get stuck into a rut, the easier we want to settle for the quiet life. And we even start to get nostalgia, and the way it was is the way we want it to continue.
Creatures of our God and King, lift up your voice and with us sing. Oh, praise Him, alleluia. Thou burning sun with golden beam, thou silver moon with softer gleam. Oh, praise Him, oh, praise Him, alleluia, alleluia, alleluia. Thou flowing water, pure and clear, make music for thy Lord to hear. Oh, praise Him, alleluia. Thou find so masterful and bright, that givest man both warmth and light. Oh, praise Him, oh, praise Him, alleluia, alleluia.
I think that God, his Son, not sparing, sent him to die, I scarce can take it in. But on that cross, my burden gladly bearing, he bled and died to take away my sin.
Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art! Sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Christ shall come with shouts of acclamation and take me home. What joy shall fill my heart?
How great thou art!
How great thou art! Then I shall bow.
If you've got your Bible with you, I'm going to read from 1 Timothy chapter 4. Paul wrote two letters to Timothy. During both of the occasions he wrote these letters, Timothy was in Ephesus, where he had been sent by Paul to lead the church there, or to at least be involved in the leadership of the church there. And this is the last of a series of four messages, just a short series that I have been giving, which we have called The Growth of a Disciple. And I selected a case history of what a disciple is and what a disciple does. And Timothy is that case history. And he was almost certainly converted on Paul's first missionary journey when he came to the town of Lystra in present-day Turkey, where Timothy lived with a Jewish mother who was a believer, a godly mother, and a Gentile, seemingly non-believing father. He came from a mixed background spiritually, a mixed background ethnically, because his father was a Greek, his mother was a Jew. And then when Paul came back on his second journey and came back into Lystra, he picked Timothy up, took him with him, and he went on that second journey. And then eventually, Paul began to throw him into the deep end and send him off to Ephesus. And he wrote these two letters to him. And I want to talk about one aspect this morning that we find in chapter 4 and verse 12. He says to him, "Don't let anyone look down on you because you are young. But set an example for the believers in speech, in life, in love, in faith and in purity. Until I come, devote yourself to the public reading of Scripture, to preaching and to teaching. Do not neglect the gift which was given you through a prophetic message when the body of elders laid their hands on you. Be diligent in these matters. Give yourself wholly to them so that everyone may see your progress. Watch your life and doctrine closely. Persevere in them, in both, that is, because if you do, you will save both yourself and your hearers. The text from which I want to talk to you this morning is in verse 12, and then we'll look at the rest of the verses as the amplification of this, where he says, don't let anyone look down on you because you are young. I want to talk about young people in the church of Jesus Christ. Now, of course, what is seen as young is quite relative. When you're a teen, 30 is old. When you're 70, 40 is young. Even 50 is young. For some of you, anybody who's not yet retired is young. So it's a relative thing. And we're not sure exactly how old Timothy was, but in an attempt to try and reconstruct what we know of his life, he was probably in his 30s, but that is beside the point. He was young enough to be looked down on because of his youth. And Paul says to Timothy, don't let anyone look down on you because you're young. When I was a kid, I used to hear this little ditty, children should be seen but not heard. Do you ever hear that one? Only adults say that, of course. And most of us would say that's not true. Of course, children should be heard. But you know, sometimes in the church, there is the attitude, youth should be seen and not heard. The temptation is to move them out, stick them on their own somewhere. They do their thing, we'll do ours, and everybody's happy. But that is not true to Scripture, nor should it be true to life. In fact, elsewhere, and we won't look at this, but elsewhere, in Paul's letters, especially Timothy, he talks about the relative relationship of older men to younger men, older women to young women to elders. He says that the older should teach the younger and train the younger. The younger should respect the older. But sometimes we are so concerned to divide everybody up that we don't enjoy the enrichment of that. And the Church of Jesus Christ, if nowhere else, should be the model of intergenerational relationship and respect and love and affirmation and caring. In fact, what Paul says here is don't let anyone look down on you because you're young, but set the believers an example. Now, that's incredible, isn't it? We would have thought he would say, now, you older ones, you set the example because there's young people coming behind you and they're watching. He doesn't say that. He says, young people, you set the example. And I'll show you why in a moment. Of course, one of the issues that we face with today is that young people think very differently to older folks. And in fact, never has there been a day when young people live to a large extent in a very different world to the world of their parents. Technology has moved at an incredible rate in the last couple of decades. And all young people today are familiar with Facebook, iPods, MP3s, texting, MySpace, YouTube, iPhone. Anybody over 40 know what I'm talking about? I mean, most of us hardly know what these are. Well, some of us are just working out what CDs are. We know what videos are, and we know what cassette tapes are, but what are DVDs? What are CDs? You know, it's moved so fast. We used to talk about culture as being geographical. There's a Canadian culture, there's a German culture, there's a Japanese culture, etc. But you know, it's much more true today that culture has become generational. I'll tell you why. An 18-year-old in Tokyo, an 18-year-old in New Delhi, an 18-year-old in Frankfurt, an 18-year-old in Toronto are likely listening to the same music, playing the same games on the internet, watching the same movies, looking at the same YouTube clips, dressing in the same way. So kids in Tokyo, boys in Tokyo, teenage boys in Tokyo wear their jeans halfway down their backside. And you thought it was just your kids that did that. And culture has become a generational thing much more than ever could have been before because of the fact that the world has become such a neighborhood in terms of communication and access to what's going on elsewhere and influences that come to us all across the world. And Paul points out to Timothy that youth is both a time of danger and a time of opportunity. The time of danger he talks about in 2 Timothy 2:22, when he says there, flee the evil desires of youth and pursue righteousness, faith, love, peace, along with those who call on the Lord out of a pure heart. He says there are temptations that are not necessarily unique to youth, but certainly strong and fresh, and you face them for the first time in your youth. And he says there are dangers to which you're exposed as a young person. Flee the desires of youth, and I'll come back to this verse a little bit later on. But there's also the positive, the danger and the opportunities. The opportunity is don't let anyone look down on you because you're young, but set the believers an example. There are opportunities when you're young to have an impact. And there are three things that fall very naturally out of these verses that Paul tells Timothy as a young man he needs to do. Number one, he needs to set the standard, set the believers an example. Number two, he needs to study the scriptures. Attend, he says, to the public reading of scripture. Study the scriptures. Thirdly, stir up your gift. He says, do not neglect your gift which was given you through a prophetic message when the elders laid their hands on you. We'll talk about those three things. Let me talk first of all about the fact he says to Timothy, you need to set the standard. Set an example for the believers in speech, in life, in love, in faith, and in purity. Five remarkable things that he says a young person should set the example in. Now, normally, we don't look to young people to set the example. As I said just now, we tend to think that's the job of older people. But here's a fact. Young people are much more likely to change things than older people. Much more likely. Because the older we get, the easier we settle for the status quo, the easier we get stuck into a rut, the easier we want to settle for the quiet life. And we even start to get nostalgia, and the way it was is the way we want it to continue. Young people don't like any of those things. They need to find things and own them for themselves. And Paul says, Timothy, they're looking down on you because you're young. Don't be intimidated by that. You set the example, set the standard. You know, change is hard the older we get. We like things the way they are. But you know, many of the great movements of God start through young people. Have you ever noticed in Scripture how many times God looks for a young person? And although they become older and some of their great events of their lives, like David and Moses and Song, all took place when they were older, what happened when they were older happened when they were older because of what happened when they were younger, when they began to set a standard. It's true in history. You know, in the last 50 years or so, some of the most effective missionary movements were about young people and begun by young people. Youth with a Mission is a mission many of you are familiar with. Lauren Cunningham, at the age of 20, was in the Bahamas, and he was spending time in the scriptures and praying. And he said, I had the idea, and I believe God put into my heart, that young people can be missionaries. And he began Youth with a Mission, YWAM. Today, YWAM has 15,000 missionaries across the world. It's the biggest mission in the Western world. It began with a young man of 20. Operation Mobilization was begun by George Verro when he was 18 years of age. He took a small team, and none of them were yet 20, down to Mexico and began to distribute scripture, and it grew from there. And in the last 50 years, Operation Mobilization has seen 120,000 people go as missionaries. Many of them, of course, short-term. That was how they began, as a short-term evangelistic mission. Currently have over 5,500 full-time people working with Operation Mobilization. K.P. Yohanan was a young man in India, and he had a vision for Indians reaching India with the gospel, and he began a mission called Gospel for Asia, GFA. And today, Gospel for Asia has 16,500 missionaries, mainly from India, mainly reaching into India, most from the south, reaching into the spiritually barren north of India. Before that, people like Amy Carmichael, who went as a missionary from Ireland, Northern Ireland, to India. And she began to rescue girls, first of all, then children generally, and began a place called Dunavar near Tirunelveli in Tamil Nadu. And I had the privilege of visiting Dunavar a few months ago. And the work is still going on, though she has went to heaven years ago. And Amy Carmichael, as a teenager, began to work amongst children and young people in Belfast, and God gave her a vision. You know, she never came home on furlough in 54 years because she felt it was more important she was doing the work than coming home and talking about it. And people said, you need to raise support. She said, I don't raise support. God is my supplier. She was a young person. And I could give you many other stories like that. And the point of Paul's statement here to Timothy is to not let anyone look down on you because you are young, but instead, he says, you set an example to the believers in speech, in life, in love, in faith, and in purity. Now, I'm going to comment just very briefly on those five things. And my comments are frustrating to me because we could probably take a whole message on each of those things. He says, you be an example as a young person. Be an example in speech, is the first thing he says. He said elsewhere to Timothy, do not be ashamed to testify about our Lord. Timothy, set an example in talking about Christ and in sharing the gospel of Jesus Christ. Don't be ashamed to testify about our Lord. I'm so glad that when I was young, not long a Christian, about 16 years of age, I got thrown in the deep end by somebody who said to me, hey, go and talk to that person and ask them if they know Jesus. I didn't know what to say. And I got thrown into the deep end, and then it went on from there to other things. I'm so grateful for that. You see, sometimes we wait until we think we know what to do, and then we'll do it. No, the best way to know what to do it, even though you fumble and fail. You'll learn and you'll grow. And he says, you set an example in speech, Timothy. You make sure the things you talk about are about our Lord. Don't be ashamed to testify about our Lord. You know, sometimes even in church life, we can talk about anything except Christ. Young people, set the example in speech. Learn to talk about Jesus. Second thing he says, in speech, in life. Now, what we say and how we live are obviously related, and they ought to be the same. They should be synchronized. I think I've used this example before, but if you watch a movie and the speech is not synchronized, what do you normally say? I'll tell you what you normally say. The speech is slow. You don't say, the visuals are too fast. Because the visuals are the reality to us. The speech should synchronize with it, so it's too slow. So it is in life. And he says to me, don't just talk, live. Don't just talk, but walk, as you've heard the saying many times, walk the talk. But he's saying, don't just talk. Do set the example in speech. But young people, set the example in life. I'll come back to what kind of example this is in just a moment. In speech and life, third thing, set the example in love. Now, he doesn't mean set the example in romance. Young people often think they invented that. You know, and it's a great time for romance when you're young. But that isn't what he's talking about. He uses the word agape here, set the example in love. Agape is that love which seeks other people's good. Be concerned for other people's good. I think one of the best descriptions is in Philippians 2. Paul talks about maintaining the same love, and then he explains it. Do nothing from selfishness or empty conceit. You know, love is not about you, so nothing from selfishness or empty conceit, but with humility of mind, regard one another as more important than yourself. What is love? Other people are more important than I am. Do not merely look out for your own personal interests, but also for the interests of others. That is, you get concerned about others. And I tell you, one of the things I'm very impressed with this generation of young people is that they're very committed to righting the wrongs of this world. More perhaps than my generation were at the time. This generation much more ready to get their hands dirty, to get involved with street kids, with issues of poverty, whether it's across the world or down in the city of Toronto, of responding practically to issues like HIV/AIDS. Many young people are saying, we need to do something, we need to get involved. Set the example in love, looking after the needs of others. Fourth thing, set the example in faith, he says. Young people are often more willing to trust and certainly more willing to take risks when we get older, to step into the unknown. I mean, who is it that lines up to do a bungee jump? It's young people. We don't organize a bus trip for seniors to go for a bungee jump. Now, there are good physical reasons for that as well. But there are also other reasons. You see, when people are young, let's take risk. Now, risk and faith are not the same thing, but faith will often involve risk. A willingness to trust God and step out in obedience to God. I recommend you read Hebrews 11 sometime, which is the whole chapter describes men and women who live by faith and see what living by faith involves. He lists 16 names in that chapter of people who live by faith, plus a few others. He doesn't name them, but he talks about their experiences. And you see that all these folks who live by faith all stepped out into the unknown in obedience to God and dependence on God. And he says, Timothy, while you're young, learn to live that way. Learn to set the example of faith. And here's the most remarkable, believe it or not, the last one says, set the example in purity. Would you think that's the young person's job? Or is that the time to sow some wild oats and have fun? No, says Paul. You set the standard in purity. Now, there's a real battleground here. Never has Western culture been less Christian than it is today. And perhaps it would be true to say, nowhere is this more evident than in the sexual culture. We have moved from an objective criteria for behavior. In the age of modernism, as opposed to postmodernism, which is a sort of chronological term that we're not quite sure altogether what it means. It means anything that beyond the modern era. The modern era trusted in external facts, science. There's a big picture to which everything fits in. And there were criteria that determined your behavior. And of course, people might violate that, but there were generally accepted ways to behave and ways not to behave, and lives were governed by that. But now the objective criteria has moved to a subjective criteria where what I do has no bearing on what is expected or demanded or required or what is true or what is not, but it's what I want, what suits me. And sexual relationships have become recreational. I was in the dentist chair this last week. And of course, you have to be entertained everywhere now, so there's a TV screen above your head to watch while the dentist is doing her work. And being the boring person I am, I asked if they put it on the news channel. And one piece of news that came on was a report published this past week that 80% of teenagers who take a pledge of virginity, and that, by the way, this is in the United States, has primarily been a Christian thing to take a pledge of virginity until marriage. 80% of teenagers, said this report, who take a pledge of virginity have sex outside of marriage within 5 years of making that pledge. That rate is exactly the same as those who don't make a pledge. Now says Paul to Timothy, Timothy, wherever the crowd is running, you make sure you run the other way. Set an example in purity. And let me tell you this, young people, you need God for this. You need God, firstly, to give you an appetite for what is right. That is God's business in your heart. When you allow him to live in your heart and you submit yourself to him and surrender to him, he creates a hunger and a thirst for that which is right, a hunger and a thirst for righteousness, but not just that, with all the temptations that bombard you all the time, all the trends and all the battle that we have with peer pressure and the like. You need strength outside of yourself. And this is available to you in Christ. And that is why this is not idealism that Paul is presented to Timothy, some kind of notion. Wouldn't it be nice if this was possible? But this is realism, says Paul. Why? Because you have Christ living in you. And let me take you back to the earlier verse that I mentioned, 2 Timothy 2 and verse 22. He says, flee the evil desires of youth and pursue righteousness, faith, love, peace, and purity. Now, here's something very important. The antidote to fleeing the evil desires of youth is replacing those desires with something positive and good. He doesn't just say, flee the evil desires of youth, period. Okay? Just don't do it. Just say no. It doesn't work. Rather, he says, pursue, replace them with some of the very things he tells Timothy here to be an example in. Faith, love, peace, and a pure heart. He doesn't mention peace in 1 Timothy 4, but he does mention that in this other statement. You know, when Paul wrote to the Ephesians, he said, those of you who steal should steal no longer. And then he told them what to do. He said, earn some money and give some of it away to people in need. In other words, if you've got a problem with stealing, he said to the Ephesians, replace it with generosity. Not just stop stealing. Instead, get involved in earning some money and giving instead of taking. The antidote. It's similar here. Don't just stop, but replace it with these things that are good. When I was in my late teens, I heard somebody say one day, he said, what you are at 20, you will probably be for the rest of your life. And I have to be honest and say that scared me, and I hoped it wasn't true. But I think it is true. Now, of course, there is always hope. But by and large, while you are 20, in terms of your character, you are likely to be for the rest of your life. So it's while you're young, you need to settle these things and not say, well, you know, I'll just enjoy myself for a little while, and then I'll come and sort these things out. But when he says set the example for the believers, it sounds a bit intimidating, doesn't it? Set the example. Oh, man, are they all going to be watching me? How do I set the example? What kind of example is Paul talking about? I read something very helpful this week by Jill Briscoe. And she was talking to another woman in ministry about people's expectations. And they were discussing the pressure of trying to be role models, knowing their own weaknesses, their own frailties, their own failures, and yet people are looking to them. And the other lady said to Jill, we are called to be models, but we are not called to be models of perfection. We are called to be models of growth. I like that very much. Because you know and I know there is no perfection in our own lives. You know that. You know if people try to model themselves on us, you'd be afraid for them because of the frailties you know in your own life. But here's the model, and I love that expression that she gave to Jill. We're called to be models of growth. Let me ask you, are you a better person this year than you were last year? If you're not sure, it might be nice to ask your wife or your husband. That was the first thing, set the standard. Now, I'll have to be quick with the other two, but they're very important. Study the scriptures. is the second thing he said to Timothy as a young man, because in verse 13, devote yourself to the public reading of Scripture, to preaching, and to teaching. Now, of course, he's talking about Timothy's particular role there, and Timothy had a particular role, having been sent to Ephesus to minister to the church there. But there are general issues and general truths here as well. Devote yourself to the reading of Scripture. Because in verse 16, he says, watch your life and doctrine closely. Persevere in them. Because if you do, you will save both yourself and your hearers. Now, two things to observe there. He says, watch your doctrine. Where do you get your doctrine from? You get your doctrine from the Scriptures. Doctrine is simply putting together the truths of the Word of God about a particular issue, a particular area, in a coherent way. And so you say there is a doctrine. Who is God? Well, you go from Genesis to Revelation to answer that question. What kind of God is he? Who is Christ? Who is the Holy Spirit? What is salvation, its fullness? What is the church? All these things. You go to Scripture and you read it and you understand doctrine. He doesn't just say, what's your doctrine? He says, what's your life and doctrine? These two things must go together. In fact, these two things, I suggest to you, are completely interdependent because both flow out of each other. Our doctrine flows out of the life that we have in Christ, because when you come to know Christ, you discover this book becomes a new book. You see, well, if you're not a Christian, this book is one of the most boring books in the world. It's not even as interesting as Shakespeare. I mean, parts of it are utterly boring if you don't know Christ. And one of the evidences that Christ has come into a person's life is this book comes alive. There are things in it that, wow, this is life. This is life-giving. So the life you have feeds the appetite for doctrine and the understanding of the Scriptures, and the Scriptures feed the life that you have. So these two are interdependent on one another. And doctrine feeds that life. You see, it's no good saying, well, I have spiritual life. I have Christ within me. That's all I need. You need to have understanding of who he is and what he's doing and what his purposes are and how he wants to work in you and through you. That's why they must go together. The doctrine flows out of the life we've received, and the life grows through the doctrines of the Word of God. And if you're a Christian, you need to be reading the Scriptures. There is no shortcut. You cannot pick these things up by osmosis. You can't just hang around Christians and somehow you get it. Hang around church and somehow you get it. Hopefully these things help, but you won't get it until you are alone with this book. Attend to the public reading of Scripture, says Paul. And the third thing he says is stir up your gift. That's the third heading I'm giving. Because in verse 14, do not neglect your gift, which was given you through a prophetic message when the body of elders laid their hands on you. Once again, there's a particular application there to Timothy's own circumstances when the elders had set him apart and laid hands upon him as well. But there's a general truth here that's very important. Don't let anyone look down on you because you're young. Because you need to set the standard, study the Scriptures, and you need to stir up your gift. You need to get busy in the service of God. You see, every Christian who is indwelt by the Holy Spirit becomes spiritually gifted. You don't have to be old to have a spiritual gift. You don't have to have gone to a Bible college to have a spiritual gift and exercise it. You don't have to have some kind of degree to exercise a spiritual gift. Spiritual gifts are not just natural abilities and strengths, so they may be related to those natural abilities, but spiritual gifts are the means whereby God brings life to other people through you. It may be in serving, it may be in administration, it may be in talking, it may be in all kinds of things. But the fact it's a spiritual gift means this is an avenue where uniquely in you, there is a way in which the Spirit of God is working to encourage others. And there are people who will never stand on a platform because that is not their gift, who breathe life to other people in their encouragement of them, in their interest in them, in their care for them. In And Timothy, you stir up this gift. He said that Timothy later. He had to say it in 2 Timothy again. Stir up the gift of God that is in you, because it's easy to go stale. You know something? You can sit in the pew passively for 5 years, 10 years, 20 years. Never stir up your spiritual gift. I talked several weeks ago about being a missional church. It's not a word that's in the Bible any more than missionary is not a word in the Bible as such. But this word missional is a good word. It's a fairly new word. It's an adjective. A church that's missional is looking out from itself to engage in the service of Jesus Christ in its location and city and across the world, locally and globally. But a missional church is an army of people, young people and old people, an army of people who do not neglect their spiritual gift, an army of people who are concerned enough to say, Lord, what is it that you are giving me to do? And stirring it up and becoming active. And I don't think you discover your spiritual gift best by becoming introspective and going through checklists. I think you discover it best by jumping in the deep end and discovering either, no, I can't do this, or amazingly, remarkably, God used me in this situation. I'd never try to analyze what spiritual gifts I might have. I just know that when I got thrown into situations, I thought, well, Lord, I'm going to trust you in this. And you discover there are places where God breathes life to other people. And there are places where you don't have those gifts. And being a missional church is not just having a new name or a new definition of what we're trying to do. It's having a new attitude of heart that says, Lord, I'm available to you, that whatever it is you've equipped me with, I want to get involved in this, and I'm going to get involved. And I'm going to serve you wherever it is that you place me. And one thing about spiritual gifts is other people recognize them too. That's why he talks about the elders who laid their hands upon you, because they recognized it. They recognized it. And other people recognize. That's why we need the affirmation of others. Yes, I'm in the right place, because sometimes we like to think we might have a gift that perhaps other people don't recognize. And well, we need to think again about that. But you know, you can discover your spiritual gift and it can go stale. That's why Paul has to write the second letter to Timothy. One of the things he says is stir up the gift that's in you, because it can go stale. And you can lose it. And these aren't things that are extra to the Christian life. This is the Christian life. This is what the Christian life is about. And Timothy, whatever struggles you're having in Ephesus, and we can deduce by reading through those letters, he was having all kinds of struggles in Ephesus. One of the struggles he was is the people looking down on him because he was young. Don't let them look down on you because you're young, Timothy. And I'll tell you what to do. You give them no reason to look down on you. You set the standard. You set the example. In speech, in life, in faith, in love, in purity. You study the scriptures. You know the word of God for yourself. And of course, it's a process. You go on reading and you go on learning. You stir up that gift and you get busy and you get active and you get involved. And do it while you're young, because there's too many Christians who've sat on the pews for 30, 40, 50 years and are doing nothing. Some of you are like that. And you know it. And you're not being what the New Testament tells you to be. It is rank disobedience. And so, Timothy, while you're young, obedience is going to be the hallmark of your life. And you're going to live this way and set the standard and study the scriptures and stir up your gift. And don't let people say that's what pastors do and the rest of us can just freewheel. That's what Christians do. Let's pray together. Father, we thank you so much that all the resources we need, the ability to live as you want us to live, we have in the presence of Jesus Christ living in our hearts. But we confess, Lord Jesus, sometimes the root problem is our own stubbornness of heart, our own yearning for the comfortable, our yearning for the familiar, our yearning for the easy. And I pray, Lord Jesus, that you'll get hold of us individually and corporately as a body in a fresh way, and do not only a work in our hearts that is exciting to us and liberating and empowering and thrilling, but a work that impacts this city, this country, and our desperately needy world. We pray it in Jesus' name. Amen.
To watch this message again, go to our website, livingtruth.ca. You can also order DVDs and CDs, download transcripts, sign up for our monthly newsletter, check out the Living Truth Daily Devotional, sign up for podcasts, and read faith stories from other viewers. We love to hear from you, so send us your comments and testimonies. Living Truth is supported by viewers like you. Thank you for transforming lives through your financial participation. Tune in next week for the continuation in this series from Charles Price.
Are you a grumbler? If you are, you will have discovered that grumbling gets you nowhere. In fact, grumblers are people who have got stuck and are going nowhere. The children of Israel were grumblers. It wasn't their grumbling that got them into the desert, but it was their grumbling that kept them in the desert and prevented them ever reaching the promised land. A journey that should have taken about 6 weeks or 40 days took 40 years, and only two of the original group, Joshua and Caleb, ever reached their destination. Why was this? As they returned with the other 10 spies from exploring Canaan, let me read to you what the Bible says. Numbers 14. That night, all the people of the community raised their voices and wept aloud. All the Israelites grumbled against Moses and Aaron, and the whole assembly said to them, "If only we had died in Egypt or in this desert!" The Lord said to Moses and Aaron, "How long will this wicked community grumble against me? I have heard the complaints of these grumbling Israelites. So tell them, 'As surely as I live,' declares the Lord, I will do to you the very things I heard you say in the desert. Your bodies will fall. Every one of you, 20 years old or more, who was counted in the census and who has grumbled against me, not one of you will enter the land except Caleb and Joshua." So the men Moses had sent to explore the land, who returned and made the whole community grumble against him by spreading a bad report about it, these men, responsible for spreading the bad report about the land, were struck down and died of a plague before the Lord. Of the men who went to explore the land, only Joshua, son of Nun, and Caleb, son of Jephunneh, survived. The passage I've just read is full of grumbling. When they genuinely cried out, God heard their cry and sent Moses to deliver them. After much pain and sadness, 10 plagues, the death of the firstborn throughout the land, and the shedding of the blood of the lamb, Pharaoh finally let them go. They were free to leave, free to make it to the land flowing with milk and honey. But they got stuck in the desert. Is that you? You've come under the protection of the blood of the lamb, Jesus, set free in the strength of the Lamb by his Holy Spirit. But now, instead of being satisfied, you're stuck. You have never entered all God has for you. God brought them out to bring them in, but they got stuck. Why? Why did God say to them, "You will never enter my rest"? Because they would not enter in, into trust, and they let God know that by grumbling. Out of the abundance of the mouth, the heart speaks. If you want to know what's going on in a person's heart, listen to what's coming out of their mouth. God did, and this is what he heard: grumbling. grumbling about having to leave the past behind. We hate the desert. We miss the garlic we used to eat in Egypt. We want to go back. Grumbling about the present. We're sick of eating manna. Give us something else to eat. What you've provided is not enough. Grumbling about the future. The spies have seen big giants in the land and we dare not step into that place. In other words, God, we don't trust you. We don't trust you to be adequate in our future. When we cry out, God hears our cry and responds, as he did with the children of Israel when they cried out under Egyptian oppression, and he set them free. But when we grumble, we're not crying out, we are criticizing. And God cannot rescue criticizers and grumblers because they refuse to trust him. God had promised Moses one thing in the desert, my presence will go with you, and I will give you rest. Keep trusting my I am presence, and you will know rest. Jesus promises the same thing. Lo, I am with you always. Come to me, and I will give you rest. Do you trust him to be everything you need, or are you looking elsewhere for something else? Are you longing for the past? Are you dissatisfied with the present? Are you fearful of the future? If the answer to these questions is yes, then you're not trusting. The language of distrust is grumbling. The language of trust is praise, thanks. God, it's tough, but you are enough. I will trust you. So instead of grumbling, I will say thank you.
Attendeth my way when sorrows like sea billows roll. Whatever my lot, thou hast taught me to say, I see.